whenever I see that students are mostly struggling with the two most important things are the color and the composition. Whether it's a graphic design, whether it's layout designing, whether it's environmental designs, whether it's gaming, it's any sector related to art. All the visual artists are generally having a lot of confusion about what is, how to use color in their works, and you know, what should we keep the background, and if this is the figure looks like, and how to apply the general rules of composition, or how to compose a visual layout or a visual, how to compose a painting, how to compose an environment, whatever it is. So it is basically a language, okay? Art is basically a language. So whenever you are designing something, okay, whenever you are thinking to, you know, design something, you are basically giving a statement. Like in English language, okay, whenever we are saying something, we are basically forming a statement. So when we were born, okay, we started recognizing faces. The first thing we recognized was a mother face, okay? Then we thought, we started recognizing friendly faces. So this is how, you know, our mind reacts to visuals, okay? We start observing, we also, with the recognition of patterns, okay? We started observing what is greater, what is smaller, right? So when we see two things next to each other, we already have that thing in our mind that, you know, this is a bigger thing and this is a smaller thing. Okay, so the two most important things are visualizing or remembering patterns, and you know, we are also always and always thinking of the arrangements. So basically, composition is arranging your visual elements in such a manner that you are able to make sense. Okay, so how you will make that sense? So there are two things, okay? Like you see in this slide, I will explain you through this. Whenever we say we have to compose something, we have one figure, okay? The figure can be a human, an animal, some shape or something. So either you are a graphic designer, you are designing a layout, or you are in environment, okay, or you are a painter. So one is your figure, and the other thing, okay, which has surrounded this figure is your ground, okay? So you are basically always and always composing a figure in a ground. So composition is basically about this figure-ground relationship. That means you are giving the context to a person, okay? Now suppose, if I am saying that my composition is a static composition, okay? Everyone should look just right in the center and nothing is moving. So how will you make a static composition? You will place something just right in the middle, okay? So when you are placing something right in the middle, you are creating a static composition. That means, I would say that never do that, because yes, we use a few things. Maybe when we are saying something like, you know, stop here, okay? Or just don't move, okay? So then at those times, we are creating a static composition. Okay, now if you look at the second thing, now this is like huge. When you are saying something huge or bigger or closer to the camera, right? So the figure will come closer to the camera. Sometimes the figure is going far away, okay? So basically you are creating a context to the ground. right? Now this is, you know, falling, or this is down, okay? This is out. Maybe a human who's running out of the composition, and somebody is like, you know, who's running behind him. So if you are creating a scene like that, so half of the figure will be inside the composition, half is moving out. So that's how you are playing through the mind, okay? So you are creating a context. Now, if I look at this, okay? Now, if I am going to a garden and I am placing some still life at my house, or I am creating a painting, how will I speak to the viewer? So I have emotions, I have feelings, and every visual is about basically telling something to the other, is about your visual statement, right? So what are you going to say? So in this, if you look at this painting, this is mostly about these three flowers, okay? Yes, it's about, and also you can see that there's a line or a curve like this, okay? And there's also a curve like this. So there are three kinds of curves in composition, okay? C, S, and straights. So whenever you are making something, okay, whenever you are making something, whenever you are drawing something, just think of, you know, these three curves, okay? The C curve, the S curve, you know, some composition is taking you inside of the environment, okay? And you are thinking about the diagonals. So when you are placing something just in between, just in the center, it's, you know, it, your composition will be very, very static and there will be no interest. So to create interest, you are placing your things. Now these three flowers are in conversation. They are talking to each other, right? If I look at the second composition, now both of them have similar sizes, right? They are of similar sizes, which says that maybe both of them are equal, right? And the upper one can be a male. The pink flower shows a female, okay? So when you are creating emotions, when you are creating feelings, you are basically giving a visual statement through your painting, through your design, through your environment, okay? This is a group mass composition. This also says that all three of these are in, you know, conversation. They are also creating a hidden triangle. So these are the things why your composition is, it's a diagonal, it has a rhythmic line, okay? So why are your composition looking, why is one environment looking beautiful? Why is one painting looking beautiful? And why others are not able to do the similar kind of works, right? So if you are able to visually connect to the viewer, maybe he doesn't know that, you know, he is into the trap, but yes, he will love your work. He will be connected with your works. And this is through these lines, these implied lines, which are hidden lines. So now what I am talking about is basically leads to the next thing, which is the visual components, right? Now, these are the visual components which make our composition very, very interesting. If any of one of you doesn't understand something or have any question, you can always just ask in between, okay? And I will be answering so that you don't have any doubts as we end, right? So you are always welcome to ask if you have any doubts. Okay, now we are moving to the visual components. So line, tone, color, shape, space, rhythm, direction, and movement. So these are basically the visual components. They connect to us visually, right? We connect to them. Lines. Lines can be your horizon line. Now, what is a horizon line? When you have a ground, okay, and the line from where you will see everything. I mean, the viewer is here. So this is basically the horizon line. So where you are placing your horizon line, is it in the middle? Disaster, okay? Because if it's in the middle, you are not even able to communicate clearly that what are you going to talk, I mean, what are you talking about? Are you talking more about the buildings or are you talking about the road? When it's in the center, it's like, you know, half road and half building. So that's a disaster. So never place your horizon line in the center. Just place it either below or either above, so that you are clear that you are talking about the road, or you're talking about the building, you are talking about the clouds, or are you talking about the sea or the beach? I mean, whatever the scene is, okay? So line is very, very important. Implied lines, I told you that implied lines are the hidden lines, okay? So these are the lines which are actually not there, but still they are there through the other visual components, like we saw here, okay? You don't see a line here, but still there is a line, okay? You don't see a triangular line here, but still there is a line, okay? So that means you are directing the viewer that you have to look here, then you have to go here, and then you have to come down. So you are making a movement in your composition, which is very, very important. Okay. You can see these two environments, they are two different environments, right? One is a painting, one is a conceptual art by some artist. And still you can see that, you know, can you compare these two? Can you tell me, can any one of you tell me that what are the similarities in these two? You can always answer me. What is meant by negative positive aspect under the heading shape? Oh, I will come to that. I'm coming to that. And what is flat or limited space? Yes, I will be taking that. Don't worry. I was just telling you about the lines. So I'm asking you that, are you able to see something here, some similarity in these two? Yes, the V-type composition in both, right? The triangle line, yes. The light and the shade. Okay, yes. Yes, so basically they both of them are forming a triangle. Both of them are forming an implied V line, right? The line is not there, but still it's there. And, you know, since we know these lines, you know, we know W's, we know V's, we know S curves, we know C, right? So we are easily able to communicate through these lines. And we know that, okay, here I have to look, okay? This is a triangle. So if you are placing your components there, you are easily, anybody who is watching or who is seeing your composition is easily able to connect. We have some more questions. Triangle line, yes, yes. Yes, the horizon is also below, yes. Okay. So one of the components we have discussed, that is line. The other component is tone or value, which is very, very important. Of course, the whole picture will not have just one value. It will have various values. But I will say that try to keep your composition in 3 to 4 values. Okay. So one will be average light, one will be average shadow. Okay. And one can be a highlight and one can be the darkest shadow or the darkest place where where the light is not able to reach. So just try to keep your composition. We will be coming to value one more time. Colors are very, very important. I will be taking them in detail after the composition. Shapes. Now, keeping variety of shapes in your composition, right? Keeping repetition, okay? Like suppose if I am composing a bouquet, okay? And if I take various flowers, okay? One rose, one sunflower, one some other flower, one some other flower. The visualizer or the person who's seeing the composition will get totally confused. So what you have to think about is that, you know, there should be some repetitions, okay? And it creates a unity. The most important thing in any painting or in any visual design is creating unity. Creating unity through values, okay? And if you are able to create unity with variety, it's a bonus. You know, your visual, whatever it is, will look excellent. Where you are, you have the grays as well as the colors, or it can be unity in lines and then one different kind of a line. Okay, so some unity and some variety. So shapes also, you should have repetitions. Okay, I would not say just one shape in every, in the whole composition, but yes, repetitions of color, repetition of shapes, repetition works wonderfully. Difference, of course, there is a difference in, you know, the shapes. Okay, so that difference, I mean, if you are placing two shapes together, the middle difference or the space is also plays a very, very important role. Positive and negative. Now, what do you mean by a positive shape? So if I have a composition, okay, like this, in this composition, I will come. Now, this is a positive shape, okay? And these areas, okay, these are my negatives. These are my negatives, okay? So which make my shape, okay? So these are my negatives because... So when you are constructing something, if you just look at the negative shape, you will be able to, you know, construct automatically the positive shape. So here I am more concentrated about the negative shape, but still I am actually able to make a positive shape. So both of the things are important, the negative shape as well as the positive shape. Space, of course, flat space is a composition which is very, very flat, which doesn't have perspectives. Okay, perspective, you would say that, ma'am, here also we can't see any perspective, but it has a color perspective. Okay. You can see that this is the main element and the things which are going far have color perspective. Okay, so perspective can be created through various things. So a flat space is where, you know, just you have an element right there and on the horizon line, and there is no, you are not creating a deep space. Okay, so if we look at here, okay, so in this composition, this S curve is taking us into a deep space. Okay, the colors which are near to us are light and see how the colors are changing and how the implied line and how the scene is being composed. Why do you like a scene? Okay. Now you should be able to answer. Even when you design something and somebody likes it, you should know. It should not be, you know, just by like, you know, if it's happening just like that, then you will not be able to do it one more time. Okay. So that's how we judge a person. Okay. Like, he's a good designer. He's a brilliant designer. A good designer who's sometimes good, sometimes not good. But a brilliant designer knows, you know, how to compose my layout. From where, okay, I have to start. How I have to take the viewer from one position to the other position. Okay. So he is basically the director. He is giving directions. Even if you are, whenever you are seeing, looking at a design, okay, it's an ad, or you see a hoarding outside, like Shopper Stop, okay. So you see that red thing, okay, and you are like, oh, you have to stop here. So that's just written in the middle. That's a static composition. That's why you just stop. So all these things should directly come to your mind now, that how I have to compose my layout. Okay, and what are the visual components, how I have to use implied lines, how I have to use values, colors we'll be coming to, shapes, okay, and space we talked about. Now, what is rhythm? Rhythm is just like, you know, you heard of music, right? And you have some nodes in them, okay? So the flow of the music. So when we were born, we are already being, you know, designed like that we have a visual sense and we know that something is disturbing. You may not be able to judge it. Okay. You may not be able to think about it that, oh, I don't know, but something is not good about this layout or something is not good about this visual. So, that is when, you know, you have everything. But then you don't have balance of colors. Okay, maybe the saturation is very, very high of some colors. Okay, so the rhythm or the flow is broken. Now you can see that, you know, when we come here, okay, so they already have a rhythmic line. Okay, they move like they move in a flow. Okay, they follow a rhythm. So that kind of rhythm you have to think about, you know, when you are creating a visual scene, the same rhythm you can see here. Okay. What a beautiful thing. Okay. Look at here, how he's, and even here, the flow, look at the colors. They are not very bright. Okay. And still you are enjoying them. Notice the value contrast, the direction lines, the rhythm and the curves, right? Now, what is the direction lines? These implied lines are actually your direction lines or except these are the forces on the shape. Like suppose if I'm taking circle, right? Then the circle doesn't have you know, something pulling it towards any, it's right there in the center. Okay. It has no forces applied on it. But if I make an oval, okay, an elongated shape, now it has a direction. So even shapes have direction. And whenever I'm creating flowers, okay, now this painting was actually about the dying sunflowers. Okay. I brought some flowers, and I was not able to paint them for very long time. And I was sitting and I thought that before they die, at least I should, you know, make one painting out of it. So now you can see the lines, okay, the rhythm of the petals, how they're going down. And so you can see, okay, and also it's taking you to the end, you know. So it has that feeling of dying. So how is that being created? Because you are taking the viewer towards the end. It will never be done. You will never do this in a happy composition. No. Okay. But here you are doing it thinking in mind, okay, that how I have to, you know, take my viewer and what is my visual statement. Okay. So if you have any questions, I'll be looking at the questions. Flat or limited space. I hope you understand, Prerna, now that what is a flat space. Okay. A space which is not at all deep, just flat right there. Okay. How one can practice the composition. Yes, it's a very good question. You can draw live, okay? Just go out, draw plein air, okay? Sit in a park, sit somewhere, and or maybe when you are sketching right there in your house, and try placing figures, and suppose two people are sitting and talking, and you are just placing them. So make lots of layouts, okay? Make a lot of drawings. They can be just value sketches. They can be just, you know, black and white drawings, 3 to 4 values added, or just 2 values added. One, the plain white sheet, and the one can be your black pencil sketch. Okay, so you can make various layouts when you are composing one single thing. Okay, even if you are making, you have a plant at your house, and if you're composing just a plant right there in the center, just think about the various compositions, that how will I compose one single scene in various manners. You can, you know, years ago, I saw a movie, I saw the making of Prince of Egypt, and they showed various, you know, storyboards, layouts, and things related to that. And, you know, how they were composing just one single scene. And, you know, they painted so many backgrounds, so many scenes right there, you know, painting the same sunset every day, coming to the same frame, and creating and thinking about that, okay, that this is the right mood which is required in that scene. So you also, whenever you are, because you all are, I think, you know, you will become a wonderful concept artist sometime. And so this should be very, very, can you show some examples of bad composition so that to understand the wrong composition? I don't here have some examples of bad composition, but yes, you see that, you know, the compositions which do not create much interest, like if I am composing something, you know, if I am composing something, this is my whole sheet, and if I am composing something very, very small and leaving the whole area like that, but no direction line. Or maybe sometimes that, you know, two people are there in the composition, and they're very, very far away from each other. Okay. And there is no conversation. I mean, you know, the things which go wrong. Okay. Also, you must have seen, I know that a lot of people do this mistake. When you go and, you know, shoot a sunset, or when you go to a place like Taj Mahal, or, you know, any of such places, what people are actually doing when they are clicking a sunset is that they are just placing the sun in the middle, in the center. So now this kind of a composition is like, you know, here the clouds are there, here the reflections are there. So this is a composition which speaks about nothing. So whenever you see a painting which doesn't speak about anything, Okay, so that means it's composed either in a wrong way. Okay, it doesn't have a visual statement. It's the things are just lying there like that. Okay, and not conversing to you. So how the things are lying? So the things are lying where, when you don't know. Right. So when we, as beginners, we used to do a lot of mistakes. We used to create a lot of bad compositions. And with time, we know that even we could have done this sort of a mistake when we would have gone to click a sunset. Okay. I have seen many people, my family members, when they are coming with their pictures. So most of them are doing this mistake. Now, what you are not actually communicating anything. If you are talking about the if you are talking about the reflections, then the sun should be placed somewhere here. And the story is more about the reflections. So, or maybe if you go to, you must have seen many paintings where a viewer has shown 100 of flowers in one scene and you can see all of them. So a photograph can be like that. But even a good photographer will change that scene so that he's able to create, he's able to diffuse few things. He's able to focus on, he's focusing on one thing. So don't, consider each and every, I mean every element will not have the same importance. So you are talking about one person. So that person will be the important person. I can also, I would also like to give you an example. Like if we have a family, okay, and there's a small kid and the story is about the small kid. So the story revolves about the small kid. Now who is the member who is next to him is his mother and then the rest of the family. So when you are composing something, just think about this concept that where is my child? Okay. Where is the mother? That means the second important thing. And then the rest of the family. So that is how basically your composition moves about. Okay. Now this composition is about these two things. Okay. So this is basically a flat sort of a composition according to me. This could have been a better composition. This is a deep space, okay? And this is also more like, but how we do justice to it, that we diffuse these flowers, okay? And we are creating curves, okay? We are actually creating curves so that the eye moves on. How to balance a flat composition into a deep space. Yes, so Siddharth, it is recommended to draw a composition from a picture of the composition, or is it better to do it when it's in front of you physically? I think it's always better if you go plein air because you will learn a lot of things. Definitely you can draw from a picture, but then it would be nice if after doing a lot of plein air sessions, then if you look at a picture, you will be able to know that what are the things I have to concentrate upon and what are the things I should leave. How are we going to find a positive and negative space in black and white bold color picture? Depends if the background is black and the flower is the main component, then the flower is white and the rest of the elements are the negative portions. Okay. Do you have any more questions or should we start with colors? Do you have any more questions about composition? Are you confused about the composition? Banners and mailers and collateral and website. What about graphic design artwork? Even in graphic design artwork, okay, even, I mean, even when you are taking a graphic design, you are actually directing the viewer. Okay, so you are using bold shapes. Okay, you are telling, of course, if you're using a square and a triangle and a circle, all three of them will not be of equal sizes. Okay, so you have to think about it, that my elements should not be of equal sizes. One will be the the most important thing. Like, we are designing a newspaper, we are designing a magazine. Okay, so I know that Hindustan Times, the name of the newspaper, will be the most important thing. Then will be my headline, and then will be my subheadline. So you are actually making the viewer understand this is the most important thing. Then read this, okay? Then come to this point. And that's how, when you are making a layout, you are thinking about banners, mailers, okay? You are designing a banner, and suppose the banner, the main headline, what it is all about. So that line should be more important. Sometimes the visual is more important. Sometimes the copywriting is more important. Like, suppose, I say that, look at these poor people of India, right? So now, first, my statement should come, because I'm saying, look at these people. Now, if I'm showing the poor people first and then my writing comes, it will be, it's a pity, India is still poor. Okay, so you first saw that picture, you were disheartened, and then you read the line. Okay, if it's like, look at these, then first you will read the line. So the line will have bold color, and it is more important, and then is your visual. Sometimes the visual is more important. It will have bold colors. It will have such placement that you look at it first. Why the chapter in a book is written boldly on the top? Because, and why is that? Because we know that we are reading from left to right. Exceptions are always there, like Urdu book, but we are mostly reading from left to right. Right. So you are always thinking that whenever you are seeing a layout, you mostly go from left to right. Okay. And then you go from top to down. So your most important things have to come in the top, right in the top. So if the visual is more important, it is in the top. If the statement is more important, it will be in the top. It will be in bold colors. So you have to play like that. How can we bring movement into our composition? Just the way I showed you, through the curves, through the rhythmic lines. Okay, so you can create such, sometimes there are converging lines. Okay, so many rays coming out of one composition, that's also create movement. Okay, bursting out composition. I will show you. Okay, so the next important thing is colors. Do we have more questions? I think we covered all. I am preparing portfolios for colleges, so some of the colleges are saying not to keep negative space white. Why? I would like to see your portfolio, so you can DM me after this, because I don't know, because it depends on the kind of pictures you are placing. Okay, so every time the negative space will not be white. It can be gray also. It can be of any color. Negative space doesn't mean that it is a white space. Okay, if I am making the painting of a white flower. Okay, so this is basically, like you can see here, that you can see here that this is a positive shape and this is the negative shape. So basically, when you are placing your layouts in your portfolio, the negative space doesn't go, the white color doesn't go with your composition. So you can keep some neutrals, you can keep some grays, color grays, greenish grays, bluish grays, whatever goes with your composition. So you can keep it like that. Any more questions? I'm sorry, I could have, you know, keep the examples of bad composition because V line sometimes is similar. Okay, no, I think we have covered all the questions, and we'll move on to the other thing, the most important thing, that is color. Now, after the composition, because after we have given them, the viewer, the direction, now is pleasing the viewer, and then comes the color. So color basically has three most important things, and that is hue, value, and saturation. And yes, temperature is also very, very important. So I would say that hue is basically the name of the color. Okay. So like blues, ultramarine blue, cerulean blue, you know, cadmium blue, or French ultramarine blue, Pathello blue. So there are so many blues. So the name of the color is basically the hue, right? Value. Now, what is value? Value is basically the lightness and the darkness of that color. Okay. So how much amount of light is there basically determines the value. So if you can see here, the light entering here is much than these areas. So even if the color is the same, this has the lighter value and this has the darker value. So since this is a watercolor, I am creating it by adding just water. You can create it by, you know, if you're using Photoshop, you can always have that. I think it's more easier for you to adjust your values, and you can easily make them much more difficult in a palette, right? This is a lighter value. Okay. Now, even two colors can have same values. Like, of course, red is a much warm color and green is a much cool color, but at some point, both of them can have similar value. Now, if I look at this green, okay, and maybe this red or this red, so they both looks like they have similar values because they are, you know, neutrals. They are neutrals. They are more in talking terms. So when two colors are able to interact to each other, they are able to talk to each other. Okay. That we can do by creating similar values. Okay. So whenever we are making a composition, whenever we are drawing a painting or a visual scene, in every visual scene, except the most important element or the focal area, when you are talking about the background areas, so how will you make the background more diffused? So you will make it more diffused by keeping the values similar. Okay. And when you have to create a contrast, you can also do it by values. So you will have sharp color means higher value. Also this is, so the lightness or the darkness of the light in a color is the value. People are students are very, very confused with values and saturation. Now saturation is the gray in the color. Okay. So if I am mixing the color and making it neutral, okay. So the more gray is in my color, it's more unsaturated or desaturated. And the more fresh my color is, it's highly saturated. So we have to keep these two things in mind, that value means more light or less light, and saturation means more gray or less gray. So these are the things when we are, you know, making a background, and like suppose areas like these, okay. So these are the areas with mostly similar values. But now if I look at these two areas, this is a much lighter value and this is a much darker value. So now these areas have contrast in their values. So by creating a visual contrast or a value contrast, you are creating a focal point in your composition. Okay. So wherever you have to keep the most important element, that is your focal area. That is your area where your most important thing will be. So you can do it by edges also. You can do it through various things. But here we are talking about color. So you will do it by keeping the colors in the similar value or by creating contrast, right? Here also, okay. Now this is a composition with complementary colors. Now I would like you to, you know, because you know we can't discuss everything in this small webinar, but I want you to go through various color combinations. I would like you to go through like what are analogous colors, what are complementary colors, through the color wheel. So if whenever you are studying something, you should know about the primary colors. Of course, I hope that you know about them, the red, yellow, and the blue. Okay. And then the secondary colors are green, violet, and orange. So blue and yellow will make green, red and blue added will make a violet. So now the colors which come on the opposite side of the color wheel are basically the complementary colors. Like yellow and violet are on the opposite side of the color wheel, okay. Green and red are on the opposite side of the color wheel, and blue and orange are on the opposite side of the color wheel. So complementary colors are those colors which create the highest contrast. So whenever we are using, you know, the complements of the colors together in a painting, we are actually creating a very bright kind of a painting. So these paintings are basically, you know, where I am balancing the complements. If I have a red, I also have a green. Okay. If I have a little orangish here, I also have a blue. Okay. If I have some pinks here, I have a gray. So this is, you know, playing with the complements. Okay. The second most important thing, except the color combinations of the color wheel, are the color grays. Now the color grays. You can see here in this picture that how the saturated version. Okay, we have a lot of questions here. Can you explain more about tonal value? Yes, I will be coming. Indian design and international design are different view. Yes, they are different in various terms, but then depends on the designer basically. Please suggest any book on composition. You can read the Edgar Penne's book on composition, EDGAR. I will I will write on the chat. Okay. You can always refer to this book. It's a beautiful book on composition. Okay. So I was talking about the saturation and the color grays. So whenever we see a more subtle painting or where the colors are talking to each other, so they are basically because of these color grays. Okay, so these, you can see these areas, okay, they have greenish grays, they have bluish grays, and you can also see how I have created one focal area just by, you know, adding a bright saturated color against the color grays. Okay, why I'm not able to. Okay, so these are your saturated colors. You can see, you can also see the complements here. Okay, the violets with the yellows, the reds against the greens. Okay, the whites and the darks. So you are always, you know, thinking of contrast, contrast, contrast when you are creating a painting like that, because flowers is a subject like that where, you know, sometimes highly saturated things look very beautiful, but still I am balancing them. If you look at here, okay, it's being balanced with some color grays. So if the whole area will be full of just saturated things, then the composition will be very, very, you know, you will not be able to either look at the composition or it will be, you know, disturbing in your head. Okay. Coming back to the values, the lightness or darkness of the color. I actually want you to see that how you can make simpler layouts with just the values, okay? And before you go further in the color, you can always think of a value sketch so that, your layout can be a value sketch and then you can convert it into colors. So you can see here that the color, this is just a color sketch in three or four values. So you can also create something like this. Okay, the light, the highlight, right, and the darks, okay, and some grays in the background. So you can also create some things like that. You can see that how, you know, environments and things are being created using the value sketches, and how you are taking the viewer. Just look at these compositions very, very carefully, and you can see that, okay, even through the value sketch, you are able to create through the values, you are actually creating a pattern. Okay, so you can see that this is my negative area. Okay, and this is my positive area. Automatically the viewer is going to come here. He will not go. And now since I have added this shape here against the contrast, you can see, I told you about the value contrast or the color contrast. So the darkest shape against the whites, bring your attention just there. So you know that this is my focal area. Similar in this, the outer areas are dark, okay? Okay, and you are actually directing through the lines, through the converging lines, how they are, you know, taking you inside that. And since, look at this white highlight created against this. Why it is being created? Just to enhance the value contrast so that you are able to go directly towards the focal point. So I think value contrast will be very, very clear if you look at these compositions, okay? That, you know, you can always see that how just by placing a darker shape against a lighter area will make your make your eye move towards that. So you can also go and sit and sketch and make various environmental sketches and show it to your teachers. And I hope that, you know, if you keep this exercise going, it is going to benefit you in future. So I think we have covered the contrast in colors. We have covered the saturation and the color grays. Now the temperatures. Temperatures are very, very important. Now, what are temperatures? The warm colors. So when we look at the color wheel, now color wheel has one side, it has the reds, and one side it has the cools. As the temperatures already tell you that, you know, the colors which are closer to the, you know, towards the warmer side are the warm colors, and also they are present in nature. If we look at sun, if we look at fire, if we look at anything which is, you know, warm or burning or you know, things like that. So if you are thinking about colors related to food, so of course warm colors, right? If you are thinking about a deodorant, of course cool colors. So that's how you are basically thinking about colors. Even your moods, right? If you are creating an environment and you are saying that there are old people and they're about to die, or it's a starry night or things like that, of course you are going to keep grays, blues, more cooler backgrounds. Okay. If you are you know, taking the viewer towards a sunny morning or something like that, so you are basically talking about the warm colors or the warm temperatures. So that is how you have to choose, okay, that how you can see that how moods in these various. Also, one most important thing is that a warm light will produce cool shadows. And now, why is that a warm light? Because the areas where the warm light is not reaching, suppose here I have a sun, okay, this is warm, this is yellow, and it's touching these areas. So the areas, so these are more yellow, these are more warm. Against these areas, which are its complements or more violetish or more cooler. Okay. These are the areas where light is touching. The light is touching here. It's more warm. Now, in the same color, if I add blues, right, I'm able to make my shadows because there the warm light is not reaching. So if we are showing a cool light, like a tube light or a morning light or a skylight. So skylight, morning light, such lights are cooler lights, right? So if you are showing an environment in a cool light, so now the areas where the environment or the light is not able to reach, they will be the areas where the colors will be warm. So when the light will be cooler, you will have warmer shadows, and when the light will be warmer, you will have cooler shadows. This thing will help you a lot in your, you can see that here the light is mostly cool, so the shadows are mostly, you know, browns and more warm. Okay. Now I will be just, you know, closing the session, and I am just, these three slides are basically the sum up of the you know, whole thing, that you can see that why they look beautiful. Now you see that, you know, lot of movement somebody was asking about. Look at the lines, look at the converging lines, look at the burstness. Okay, so whatever I am creating, keeping in my mind that how it will, how a viewer will look at it. Okay, look at this white with the bright contrast. Of course, the viewer is going to come here first, right? Similar way here, creating contrast. Okay. Now here, if you look at the areas here, similar values, okay, more dull, no contrast, right? Through lines, I am taking the viewer in, out. So, you know, I have implied lines always there. So when I am making a subject, I'm always and always thinking about the values, the color contrast, saturation, color grays. I'm thinking about the lines. I'm thinking about the shapes. I'm thinking about the space. I'm thinking about the negative area. I hope that you are getting everything, and let's take the questions now. How can we bring movement? Prerna, I answered you. Can you explain more about tonal value? I think now you have got it, the tonal value. What is the meaning of warm shadow? Warm shadow means the shadow which contains warm color. Warm colors like reds, like browns, okay? Not blues or greens. So if you look at the color wheel, you will see that, you know, that one side of the color wheel has cooler areas and one side has the warmer areas. So the reds, the yellows, the oranges, they are the warm colors. So whenever there will be a cool light, that cooler light will not be able to reach those areas. So the shadows will automatically be more warmer.